So our group, the company we're presenting at is Patagonia. So to start off for our table of contents, we're going to start with some company history and then go over Patagonia's mission statement. And then we'll go into the four P's and PESTEL breakdown. And then we'll go into the SWOT analysis. And then lastly, we'll go to our target market and buyer persona. To start with some company history, the founder is Yvon Chouinard. He's an avid rock climber. He started rock climbing in 1953. And then in 1957, he taught himself how to blacksmith and started blacksmithing his own climbing gear. And then in 1965, he teamed up with Tom Frost and they started Chouinard Equipment, made all sorts of different climbing gear with Yvon's blacksmithing skills. And then going into 1970, they became the largest climbing supplier in the United States. They started selling out of the back of Yvon's car, and they started founding their own factories and shipping out and distributing climbing gear. And then when Yvon was on a trip in Scotland, he had bought a rugby jersey off a local and climbed in it and used the collar of the rugby jersey to protect his neck from the gear. So that's kind of how they started bridging into making their own clothing. And then in 1973, it changed to Patagonia. And then obviously they've developed into a huge outdoor company now. It's been quite a few years. And then not too long ago in 2022, they changed their ownership into the Patagonia Purpose Trust. And that was all the focus on putting money towards climate change. So for Patagonia's mission statement, it is, we're in business to save our home planet. And every penny that's not reinvested into Patagonia is put into some sort of charity or fundraiser for climate change. The value this brings for our customer is that when they're buying Patagonia's clothing, it's reinvested in the environment, and not only are they getting a good piece, they're doing a good thing for their earth. For the target market, it's for environmentally friendly people that are looking to make a change with climate change. And then it's obviously a little more expensive, but it's definitely worth it, so a little higher end stuff. And then we have a short video clip. This is just a little marketing video that they had.
Because they know that customers are willing to pay for environmentally friendly production. Patagonia has a price adjustment policy where if you purchase a full price item and it goes on sale within 14 days of the shipping date or date purchase, they will refund you the difference if it is still in stock. And then moving on to place, patagonia.com is their website. And anyone can access that. They also have many of their own retail stores in the United States and across various countries. Patagonia is in dealers' stores like Big Sporting Goods. And then the last P is promotion. So they really promote that environmental sustainability. And they have many social media platforms, including Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. And then they also have a Patagonia Pro program, so that's where you can sign up, get emails, get some promotions.
So now we'll get into the PESTO breakdown of Patagonia. So the first part of PESTO is the political breakdown. So Patagonia will support environmentalist policies, as stated before. So, you know, groups that support climate change, you know, air pollution, global warming, they'll support those groups and political parties. Then Patagonia also has advantage in countries with strict environmental policies. So countries that, like the United States, that has those environmental policies in place, they'll sell very well. So that's why you don't see Patagonia in a lot of countries all over the world, because the United States is one of the only countries that has these policies set in place already. And next is economic features of Patagonia. So the high cost of goods in Patagonia means they'll do better during times of high consumer confidence. So during the coronavirus, Patagonia went way down because everyone is at the bottom of the economic cycle, so no one had high confidence, they didn't want to buy any of those goods. But after that, once it started going back up, Patagonia, they had a lot more sales, and now Patagonia is selling very well after the virus. And then also stated earlier, Patagonia does not sell very well in the less prosperous regions of the world just because their goods are so expensive and you need to have capital to buy these goods. So countries such as United States, Canada, and even like some European countries like the UK and France will sell Patagonia very well. And then the CS is for social. So Patagonia is a large market within the young people looking to spend time outside. So I'm sure a lot of you guys may have Patagonia gear or shirts or fleeces or whatever up here. And they their stats associated with the brand makes their goods easy to market to the community. So you've probably seen the Patagonia video, just like the one we showed. They market their goods while they're in use. So Patagonia does a very good job at showing their goods in use to go to the younger generation that wants to get out and use those goods in action instead of just seeing a price tag and nothing else besides that.
So there are a lot of technological things that impact Patagonia too, as with like all companies. In these days you need to have a strong social media presence to reach a lot of younger audience, which Patagonia does. If you look up Patagonia on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, you'll find like a million accounts for like their rock climbing, their like backpacking, all that stuff. So they do keep up very well with that. And they do a very good job of keeping their brand image through their social media. They post a lot of pictures of like cool scenery with their products in it, so they're just tying together their product with the outdoors, which is a big part of their brand image. And they also use their website a lot. If you look up their website, and I'll bring that up a few more times, but they, in addition to just selling their products, they also have a lot of other resources on there too. They also have a lot of legal environmental things they have to look after. So as with all clothing production companies, they have to stay true to the laws for production, making safe products and making them effectively. Like I said, their website has a lot of things. So like on their website, you can see, they like post for you to see like all where they get all of their like supplies from, where they produce it. Everything's like really transparent with them, so you know that they're keeping up legally. Another interesting thing they do is they have done a little bit of lobbying, which is of course when you pay someone to try and get someone to talk to a lawmaker about a certain policy. I think you can see online, because it's all public domain, between 2018 and 2020, they spent $380,000 lobbying the U.S. government. And when you look into it, it was mostly about environmental laws and stuff of that nature. And last is the environmental effects. As you know, with climate change, you can't wear the same clothes as you did because the weather is changing with the warming world. In Patagonia, on their website, you can see they have a very diverse product line, with several different clothing, from big puffer jackets to t-shirts and all that stuff. So no matter the changing weather conditions with climate change, Patagonia is always going to have products that work. And if climate change continues to get worse, people are going to want to support a company that is doing more for the environment. Like I think Jet said, they have established a trust where all of their revenue that doesn't go back into the company is put into environmental, like saving the environment. So as it gets worse, more people will be obligated to purchase from them because of that.
So, moving into the SWOT analysis. So, some of their strengths being that Patagonia is a well-known environmentally friendly brand in itself, so compared to others, they're already on top of that category. They have a really strong brand identity and logo, so you're basically paying for the logo on the shirt, and everyone recognizes it. And 85% of their products and 99% of them are made, or 85% are fair trade and 99% are made from recycled products.
moving on to weaknesses. They have a low slash weak e-commerce profile. They're not doing great selling products online, and they're publicly commenting on politics sometimes, which has had a negative effect on their company. And even though they're globally operated, they just have a low presence in some of those other economic communities just because of how expensive the product is. Moving to the opportunities, we need to expand online globally. Again, that can utilize the effectiveness of online shopping because everyone from different regions of Earth can get to the product. We also said they should make new products such as mountain bikes, snowboarding, other lines of sports, and then even maybe venture into a camping market. It seems like they're so stuck in being outdoors that maybe they should have like tents or like something along with that. And then the last one is going to be threats. And that's going to be because Patagonia relies purely on natural resources. So again, if climate change does happen, they're going to suffer as a company greatly just because they're all natural and organic. And they pose a threat to material availability in that sense, just because, again, if they're not making products or materials, they can't make their own clothing. And during the 2020 pandemic, obviously it suffered greatly, so that is another thing to watch out for, is like a pandemic or another outbreak like that. And then other companies. So they have a lot of competition just with like North Face, L.L. Bean, and like Columbia. So they're already in a tough market, but other than that, they've been doing very well in that sense. So that would be it for SWOT analysis.
Okay. Who can tell me which one of these is Patagonia and which one is not? Shoot.
Your
left.
Correct. That's Patagonia. The other one is just a generic vest. We just want to illustrate how Patagonia has a strong brand image. A lot of people recognize that brick pattern that they use in their vests. And that brand image really helps sell the product because people can easily identify what's Patagonia. Who's Patagonia's target market segment? They want people who are going to have gear that's going to hold up well in the outdoors. People who are concerned about protecting the environment. Anyone who wants the status that's associated with Patagonia. So Patagonia is a pretty cool brand, well respected, and it's also expensive, and so being able to wear that is a symbol of status that people are willing to pay for. Patagonia's buyer persona would be someone who's well connected and spends a lot of time in the outdoors. They're going to represent the brand well, stand for the environment, focused on bringing people into the outdoors, are going to introduce new people to the brand and what they stand for. And they're also going to be a high status person who's going to make the brand look good, make it look prestigious, high quality to potential customers. So that's all we got. If you guys have some of the basic questions to answer, if you guys want to fire away.